Hi everybody, welcome to this webinar, which is held in the context of Destiny Project. I am Simona Agostinelli, a researcher from Sapienza University of Rome, and we will see the basics of robotic process automation. In particular, in this webinar, we can see first of all, the potentiality of robotic process automation technologies that allows you to understand the user behavior from a user interface log and then emulate this behavior in place of human users. Then we are going through the UiPath Studio, which is one of the major vendors of RPA tool in the current era and allows you to develop the first software robots with a graphical user interfaces with a low-code development platform. And then we are going to see the first examples in UiPath Studio.
So, first of all, what is robotic process automation, abbreviated as RPA? RPA is an automation technology that is based on the notion of software robots. Okay? The software robots allows the organizations and the companies to automate the human behavior. Okay? So, to automate high volume routines. In particular, the software robots are mainly used for automating the repetitive office tasks, for example, operations like billing, accounting, and customer service functionalities. In particular, the software robots are capable of emulating the user actions or the user activities that are performed by a human worker on his graphical user interface. For example, typical tasks that are emulated are the login into application and then perform several tasks based on backend functionalities, connect to system API to record and emulate the keyboard inputs, also emulate the mouse movements and the clicks on the user interface. Copy and pass the data from Excel to a Google form, read data from a database, and so on and so forth. For example, open email and attachments, fill automatically the form and make calculations, and so also advanced functionalities like computer vision techniques. But we are not interested in this week about computer vision techniques. So, first of all, I would like to introduce you a small video that sketch an example in which RPA could be useful.
This video is about a student whose friends watched a movie in a theater. They enjoyed the movie and left very positive reviews. The student too wants to watch the movie. However, the student scrolls through his calendar and he finds that his schedule is overbooked with study sessions, assignments, and projects. He doesn't have the time to go to a theater to watch the film. Now, he wonders if he can watch the movie online. He already has a long list of movies that he wants to watch, and he adds this one to the list. He decides to watch the movies one by one, and so he starts looking for them on a website to watch them for free. After searching for a few movies from the list, he realizes that not all of the movies are available on the website. Also, he realized that he'll waste a lot of time going through the list and manually searching for each movie's availability on the website. He starts to get disappointed. Then, he decides to use the power of RPA. He creates a robot that tirelessly searches the website for each movie and emails him with the names of the available movies, thus saving him time. He can now focus on his studies and project work. After just a few hours, he receives notification emails with the movies' names that are available on the website. He's happy and he eagerly looks forward to watching them. Developing a robot has liberated the student from the mundane, tedious, and time-consuming task of searching for the movies on a website.
The message of this video is that this guy, instead of manually searching of all the movies, he creates a software robot and the software robot automatically searches for the movie you would like to watch automatically. Okay, so in this slide we can see the main step that the user, so the boy, has followed to write the first software robot. In particular, he opens a website, then he searches for the movie, save the results, and then starting from this list, the software robot is able to find the movies automatically by search, by reading this file. And then the last activity that the software robots will perform is to email the results, so the movies that are available on the website. So I'm talking about software robot. Here we can see an example of how a software robot works on graphical user interface. In particular, in this case, the software robot is able to mimic and replicate all the user actions that are performed on the user interface. Okay, so we can see in red all the user interactions. A software robot, which is a piece of code, okay, is able to completely mimic all the interactions happening on the user interface. In particular, software robots can perform complex calculations and decision making based on predefined rules, for example, on if-then-else activities. In particular, they are also able to interact with applications, move files or folders, and copy and paste data from different kinds of sources, perform data processing tasks with particular precision. In addition, software robots are able to work 24 hours each day, with respect to humans that work only 8 hours. There are too much, but 8 with respect to 24 is there is a big difference. So here we can see a first division between software robots. There are the attended software robots and the unattended software robots. The first differentiation between these two categories is that with the attended software robots, we mean software robots that require human inputs, okay? So it is not a backend robot, but is installed, is developed on the same machine of the user. Okay, so for example, an application that requires a login of a user is an attended software robot. On the other side, software robots that are unattended are the ones that perform workflows without the human intervention. Indeed, they are intended to work in the back office side and not in the front office. So here we can see in particular the main peculiarities of attended software robots. Indeed, they are triggered by users for specific user inputs. They collaborate with a human worker for small and repetitive tasks. And they run on the same machine of the user. While unattended software robots are running on the back side of the computer, so they are not placed in the same human computer of the human, because they do not require human interaction. So I would like to emphasize what RPA is not. RPA is not a humanoid robot, but instead it allows human to focus on more intelligent tasks. Okay, so RPA can make individuals more efficient. Indeed, a software robot will execute tasks assigned to it much faster compared to human. In particular, RPA is not a human replacement, because RPA can help workers in doing more intelligent tasks, so to free them from mundane and boring tasks. The processes that are best suited for robotic process automation are the ones that are repetitive, so they are put into a cycle, several activities that are performed in the same way, so daily routine for examples, rule-based activities that contains if-then-else statements, and the ones that are structured. This means that all these processes that respect these three constraints are good candidates for the automation. Looking at the spectrum of business process management processes, we can see that we have on the top the structured processes, so the ones that are not made up by exceptions. Then below we have the structured processes with the ad hoc exceptions, so these are the ones that require external handling activities to handle the exceptions. Then we have the unstructured processes with the predefined fragments to handle, and the ones that are unstructured. In particular, the structured processes are completely predictable, so we know exactly all the steps that are encoded within the process. In the structured processes with ad hoc exceptions, we require some adaptation during the process to concretely end the execution. In RPA, we will focus only on the structured and structured processes with ad hoc exceptions, because, as I said before, the routines, the processes that are good candidates for the automation, has to be repetitive, rule-based, and structured. Okay? In particular, the structured processes are unattended of the robots, because they do not require the human interventions. Instead, the structured processes with ad hoc exceptions require the human interventions to handle the exceptions. Are there any questions till now, or everything is clear? See? Okay. So let's move on. Looking at the current state-of-the-art technologies in robotic process automation, we can see that the first example of software robots are the chatbots. Chatbots have been used for years to accept the voice-based or keyboard inputs that are coming from the users. For example, if we think about the Segreteria Telefonica, I don't know how to say, this is a chatbot that is running on the backend, because it's trying to emulate the human behavior. Then another technology that is antecedent to RPA softwares are skill scraping tools. With the term skill scraping, we mean all those tools that allow us to extract the data from legacy application and orchestrate this data, reorganize this data into modern user interfaces. There are today's skill scraping facilities that are concretely implemented, for example, in the UiPath Studio, the tool that we will see in the next moments. Then, finally, RPA technology evolved through the workflow automation, which is the current era. Indeed, with the workflow automation, we are able to design, implement, and execute all the software robots that we would like to develop. In particular, the workflow are flowchart diagram, so sequence of activities that are connected through if-then-else statements, for loop, and other kind of data structures. So, before see how UiPath Studio is made up, it is important to understand the steps that are required to conduct an RPA project in a company. Okay, the first step is to determine which routines are good candidates to be automated. So, for example, I'm working in a company and would like to understand what type of routine I'm going to emulate. I have to talk with an RPA expert that is telling me how its behavior, how its routine is made up. Indeed, this step requires the support of skilled human experts that identify the candidate routines by means of interviews, so talk each other. The second step is to model the selected routines that are the output of the previous stage in the form of flowchart diagram, as we can see in this picture. This is exactly the picture that I take from UiPath Studio. As you can see here, we have the flowchart diagram with the start, an activity, and then a flow decision. Okay, so this is a flowchart diagram. In particular, in this second step, we are going to model the software robot through drag and drop activities. The third step is to develop each routine that is the output of the first stage by generating the software code that is required to enact the target software robot. In particular, the designer has to check if the robot's behavior during the execution of the task is capable to reproduce exactly the human behavior. If any misalignment exists, so once I develop my software robot, if any misalignment exists, then the designer has to adjust the flowchart diagram. Then the fourth and the fifth step are out of scope of this course, but it is important to emphasize. Once we developed through our editor, which is UiPath Studio, we are going to deploy the software robots in their environment to perform the action we would like to perform. Then we have to maintain the routines over time because in the daily stage something will change, and so we have to adjust the behavior of those routines. UiPath, which is a commercial vendor of RPA enterprises, is founded in 2005, so there are 15 years from now, and is established as the first leading RPA software in the world. Apart from the studio, which is the main editor that allows to develop the flowchart diagrams and then to enact the software robots, they allow you to download also the orchestrator of the software robots that we are not going to see, and also the robot part, which allow you to execute the software robots. In this course, we will see the studio tool that allow you to design automation, the flowchart diagrams in a visual manner with minimal use of code. Okay, so the main features of UiPath Studio are the following ones. It allows you to model the processes in a visual manner, to use drag and drop activities, so you don't have to study too much to understand the different programming languages as happen in high level programming languages, but it offers you a low code development platform. Okay, so it is very easy to use. In particular, there are two editions of UiPath. The first edition is the one that we are going to use. It is the community edition. I sent you the instructions on Sunday, I guess, to download and install the tool. Have you ever received the instructions on, okay? Do you install the tool or no? Okay. So we can move on. Here I put the instruction, but if all of you has already installed the tool, I can see the instructions. This is the main graphical user interface of UiPath. In particular, here we can see on the top, we can open a local project or clone an existing one from repositories, for example, from GitHub or SVN. Then on the right, we have the possibility to create a new process that the thing that we are going to do today, to create reusable components such as library to use in future moments, but we are not interested in encoding library. And there are also the possibility to test codes and also reuse several templates, templates that are already existing. So today we are going to create a new process. But first, but before create a new process, let's see all the tabs that we have on the left. Here we have all the UiPath extensions that we would like to add. In particular, in this course, we are interested in install Chrome facilities. It is not important that you do this now, because today we are not going to focus on Chrome, Firefox and Excel facilities. We are going to encode our first software robots. Okay, so only for the myth of understandability, you know that if you need to go on Chrome, on Firefox, or use Excel add-in, you have to install from this tab. So under the tools tab. Then we have several templates that we can reuse. Here there are the background process, the mobile testing project, project orchestration process, and so on and so forth. These are, we don't care about these templates. However, I have access to all the materials of UiPath. I will share this material on the Moodle page of the course if you are interested to going deeper into UiPath Studio, but for the course, we don't care. Then we have the possibility to clone the repository from a GitHub page or SVN page, but this is not our case. Then we have different settings that we have that we would like to customize, but the most important thing to do now is to create our first process. Okay, so under the start button, we click process under the new project section. Here we can rename our project. I will call it as my first project, and I will left all the other information as default. In particular, on the bottom, we have the possibility to choose between Visual Basic or C language. I suggest you to left Visual Basic. So then we have to, we can create our first project. It takes several seconds. Here, you can see the main workflow. The main workflow of UiPath Studio. In particular, on the top ribbon, we have the Home tab, which is the previous one, and okay. The Design tab that allows you to model the software robots by means of a flowchart diagrams, and in particular, looking at the top button, we have the possibility to create a new file, to export an already existing workflow, to run the file, in particular to run the flowchart diagram as a software robot, manage different packages. In particular, here you can see all the packages that are installed by default, but if you want to use Excel activity, yeah, you must type, for example, here Excel, okay? And then install the related activities. Then we have several recording facilities that allows you to record all the user actions that are happening on the user interface. In particular, you have the basic recorder that allows you to record all the activities that are happening in one application. The desktop recording that allows you to record all the activities that are happening in all the applications that are opened in your user desktop. And then the web recorder. When we use the web recorder, we will see how to use the web recorder on Friday. You have to remember to install the dependencies that I shown you before, okay? Under the tools tab. Here you will install Chrome and Firefox, and then you will be able to use the web recorder, okay? I'm just exploring all the buttons of this new tool. And if you have doubts or curiosity, interrupt me and make questions, okay? So then we have the scripting facilities that are the ones that I was talking about at the beginning of the lecture, in which you can extract the textual information from a web page. Okay, for example, if we are going to an Amazon page and we would like to screen save the data, we are going to extract all the textual information from the Amazon website. If we search to a movie, like the example of the beginning, and we would like to extract the data of that movie, we have to use the screen scraping facilities that we'll see also on Friday. The same is for the data scraping, but instead of extracting data from the web browser, we are going to extract the data from applications. Then here we have several buttons that allows you to add several user events, remove the unused activities in your workflow, but these are you need two knowledge to use this button. So we are going to focus on the essential thing of the project. So here on the left, we have the project tab. Okay, in the project tab, you can see, first of all, the version of the packages that are installed by UiPath Studio. In particular, here, there are the version of the Excel activities, the mail activities, the system activities, and the user interface automation activities that are the ones that UiPath are using by default. Then here, you can see a file which is called main.xaml, which is the main workflow in which you are going to drop the activity. Okay, so this is the software robot that is empty, that it does not contain any activity. For the activities, you have to push the activities button. Here, you can see there are several activities. In particular, these are the ones that I'm using in recent. In particular, I have the message box that allows to prompt a window on the screen, for example, a message that is a pop-up message. Then we have the sequence activities that allows you to encode a sequence of activities, for example, a sequence of a message box, a sequence of clicks, and so on and so forth. However, since I cannot iterate through all the activities, it's important to understand that all the activities are grouped by category, okay? For example, you have the possibility to choose different activities by category. For example, application activities, clipboard activities that allows you to copy and paste the data from the clipboard, and so on and so forth. Okay, so in particular, in this, in our first example, we are interested in using the message box activity. Now we are going to implement our first automation project, which is the Hello World automation project. In particular, we would like to build a workflow that prints the Hello World in a message box. So all the things that we have to do are the following ones. We have to come back into UiPath, and we have to search, first of all, to the sequence activity. Okay, the sequence activity is the main skeleton of our software robots. When you have to encode several activities in a sequence, you have to drop the sequence activity just there. Okay, so the steps that I did are the following ones. I double click on the main XML, and then I search for the sequence activity under the activity panel, and I simply drag and drop it on the main screen. Okay, I can rename my sequence and I type hello world. Okay, so our first task is to pop up a message hello world. The activity that allows us to print hello world is the message box activity. So as before, I'm going to the activities panel, I click it, and I drag and drop the message box. Here, the message box activity suggests me that the text must be quote. So I'm going to quote the message hello world, and then I will run, I will save first of all the file, and then if there are errors, they will show, the UiPath Studio will show to me on the console, which is here, okay? In this case, we have no error, so we can continue to run the file, and let's see what happened. Okay, a pop-up will appear on the screen. Oh, this is a mischief here, but it's okay. A pop-up appears on the screen and everything is okay. Now, I would like to do a further step. In particular, instead of printing the hello world message, I would like to print my name, okay? For example, hello Simone Agostinelli, but instead of hard coding the string in the message box, I would like to create a variable, okay? A variable is a container, let's say container, that allows you to store data. In particular, it allows you to store different type of data, for example, string, integer, collections, and so on and so forth. So let's create our first variable that I will rename as name. Then we have the type. In particular, you can choose from these types, and we are interested in string because Simona Lucinelli is a string. So I pick string, the scope. What is the scope? The scope is the zone under which this variable is visible. You have a studio is saying that the scope is hello world. It means that our variable is visible under the hello world sequence and not outside. Here in the default field, I'm going to encode the value. So my name between quotes. Okay, so here I'm going to delete my name and I will add the variable that I just created. So, hello plus name. Okay, so I save my file and then I'm going to run the file. Okay, so now I'm exploited a variable to store the value of my name. Now I would like to do an additional step. I would like to ask the user to insert his or her name and then print the inserted name. So now I have to search under the activities package the activity input dialog. Okay, so I select it and I drop this activity under the sequence hello world. Okay, so the input dialog is a pop-up that allows the user to insert a value. In particular, I have to put here the label that I would like to appear on the user interface. So in this case, insert your name. Okay? And I want that the value that the user will type is stored, will be stored in the name variable. Okay? So I'm going to edit the default value because it will be assigned a new one when the user is going to type the value. Then after the variable name is changed, I would like to output the value of the name that we inserted. So I save the file and let's see if everything is working. Insert your name here, insert Simone Agostinelli. I will put OK. And then the message box is going to prompt out the value that is inserted within the input dialog. Let's try to change the value. For example, instead of insert Simona Agostinelli, let's insert Andrea Marrella. And let's see what will happen. Okay, hello Andrea Marrella. So by summarizing the steps that we did, we first clicked on the main file, which is the main workflow. This file is encoding the software robots. So double click on it and we first have an empty page. Okay, then we searched on the activities panel the sequence activity, which is this one. And we drop it on the main screen. We need the sequence activity because Inside this activity, we have several activities that are in sequence. So we have a container that is able to store all this activity in once, at once. Everything is clear up to now? Okay. So then we see the variables panel here. Just remember that this panel allows you to create variables that you can use in your in your flowcharts. Okay. And then we can move on the next on the next examples. So now we would like to move the files from a source folder to a destination folder. In particular, here on the desktop, I have two folders. The source folder that contains three files and the destination folders that contain no files. Our second software robot has to copy and paste all these files from the source to the destination folder. So let's close this project, and then we can start a new project process. My second project. Let's click on create. Now, since implementing directly this software robot will be hard, we can move step by step. So the first task will be to copy, to cut and paste one file to the destination folder. All we need is the move file activity. The move file activity allows you to move just one file from a source folder to a destination one. But we need first to drop in the UiPath Studio the sequence activity. Okay, so I will rename my sequence by double clicking on it, and I will rename it as move from source to dest. Then I have to search for the moving file activity. Here, the move file activity require the input file, okay? So we are going to pick the file on the desktop, which is under source, and I will pick the file one, and I will select also the destination folder. The destination folder is the under desktop, this one, dest folder. Then I want to, this is a flag that is saying that when this flag is checked, all the files that are already existing in the destination folders will be overwritten. Okay, so I will flag this. And just for curiosity, on the right you have the properties panel. The properties panel allows you to specify some properties of the different activities. For example, we will see in the next moment, this tab allows you to change the different data types of the activities. Okay, so as a matter of fact, here you have some properties that if you want to customize, you can do it here on this tab. So now that we have implemented the first moving, let's see if everything is working. So let's save this project, and then we can run it. Okay, let's see if everything is worked or not. Yes, in the destination folder, I have one file. And let's see if in the source folder, I have two files, okay? So the file is correctly moved from a source to the destination folder. Now we can make the second step. I initially say that I would like to process all the files from one folder to another. So I would like to move the three files and not just one from the source folder to the destination one. How is possible? We can exploit the for each activity. The for each activity is a statement that allows you to iterate over different elements. In this case, I'm using the for each activity to iterate all over the files of a folder. Okay, in particular, on the left, I have the single file, the single item that in our case will be the single file. So I change the value item into file. And then here on the right, I have to put the expression that is going to select all the files from the source folder. Here we can use low-level programming languages. Indeed, here I have to write this statement that now I will explain. Directory is the main class, as like in Python or Java, that contains different methods. Create directory, delete, enumerate directories, and so on and so forth. In particular, we need the method getFiles. Okay? So, with this statement, I'm going to say that I would like to take all the files from the source directory. So I'm going to copy and paste the source path from here into WePath. Okay, I have the strings has to be double quoted. Okay, so we get an error. And then I want to move each file, which is this one, with the for each statement, we are going to iterate over the three files that are contained in this directory, okay? So in the body, which is this field, in the body, I'm going to use the move file activity. So I just, as I said at the beginning, the drag and drop relies also on this movement because it is easy to move activities from one side to another. Okay, now be careful that in the from field, I have to put the variable file, okay? File. In each iteration is going to to address the three different files. So at the first iteration, a file contains the variable file will contain the path C users, Simone, desktop, source, file 1. In the second iteration will contain C users, Simone, desktop, source, file 2. And at the third iteration, C users, Simone, desktop, source, file 3. So file is a variable that stores the file path of each file. Okay? I have to cut file 1 into source. Wait a moment. And then we can see here that we have an error. Wait a moment. No. Allora. So, this error is saying that the for each statement by default works with object and not with string, okay? File is a string because, as I said before, it contains the file path to file 1, file 2, and file 3. So, I have to change the default type of the for each statement. How can we do it? We can click on the for each statement. Then, as I said before, in the properties panel, we can customize the different properties of an activity. In this particular case, we are going to say to UiPath Studio that the for each statement, in this case, instead of working with object, we work with strings. Okay? So, the steps that I performed is the following one. I clicked on the for each statement. On the right, it appears the properties panel. And then under the type argument, I forced the conversion of the object type, which is the default type that UiPath use for the for each activity, into string. Okay, so now let's see if everything is set. I think yes. So we save the file and we run the project. And let's see if everything is correctly working. But first of all, let me check if in the source folder there are the three files and the destination folder is empty. So I run the file and let's see what happened. The software robot have run, the source is empty, and the destination folder is correctly filled. So it's important to understand the steps we did. As before, the first step is to drop the sequence activity into the main workflow of the project because here we are relying on different activities. We are relying on the for each activities and on the move file activity. So the sequence is important for doing that. I would like to make use now of two variables rather than hard coding the different file paths within the methods. So, in particular, I would like to create two variables. In the first variable that I called source, I'm going to copy and paste the value of the source path. Okay, which is this one. So I copy and paste here. And rather than hard coding the get files method, I'm going to pass as an argument the source. the source variable. Okay, so as before, I clicked on the variables panel, and here I can create all the variables that I need. In particular, a scope is chosen by default the ones that is inside the sequence move from source to dest. Then I would like to encode within a variable also this file path. Okay, so I'm going to create another variable that I'm going to rename as destination. And here I will cut and paste the value. Here I will, as a scope, instead of body is the area inside the for each statement, I will use the move from source to dest, meaning that this variable destination is visible also in move from source to dest and not only in the body element. Okay, so here in the two, I'm going to put the destination variable. Now I will redestinate the files in the source directory. And let's check if our software robot will work. Save, run file. Let's check. Okay, the source folder is empty and the destination folder is correctly filled. So now we would like to make a last step, which is the counting of the files. Okay, so I would like to print on the screen a pop-up which is able to show me exactly the number of files that I moved from the source to destination directory. So I need another activity which is called assign. Remember that all the activities are placed on the activities tab here, just there on the left, and we are going to drop the assign activity at the beginning. This activity assign to a variable, in our case an integer variable, a value. So we can create our integer variable that we call count. So here we can define the type of the variable, which is an integer. And here we can initialize the value to zero. So count equal to zero. Since I want to count each file, I have to increment this value by one inside the body element of the for each statement. In particular, after the move file activity, because once I moved a file from source to dest, I have to increment by one. So at the end, the idea is that the variable count will contain three. So let's drop the assign activity after the move file, and I'm going to increment by one this value. So count equal count plus one. And the results will be reassigned to count. Then Then after I count all the elements, I would like to prompt this message on the screen. So as we said before, for prompting in output the informations, we have to use the message box activity. But be careful, I'm going to drop this message box not after the assignment of the count variable, but at the end, after the for each statement. Because otherwise, if I put the message box after the assigned activity, I will prompt three times the count variables. So at each iteration, it will be prompt 1, 2, and 3, but I would like to prompt only the final result of count. So as we can see from the main workflow, the for each statement is this block. And then we have the message box activity. So here I'm going to write the total number of files R plus the count variable. Here we have an error because UiPath is saying that count is an integer variable. It has to be cast to a string. Text is a string, no, not an integer. So I have to use the built-in method to string, which convert the count variable, which is an integer, to a string. So I save my file, I came back to the destination folder, I copy and paste the files from the destination folder to the source, and then let's check if everything is working. So for running the software robots, as before, on the top, we can click on run file or run. In this case, we can run on current file because we have implemented just one file. Okay, so the first step are the moving of the files from the source folder. Indeed, the folder is empty, and then at the end, a message will be prompted out. In particular, the total number of files are 3. Let's see if the destination folder is correctly filled. Okay, it's correctly filled and the software robot is working. Let's check if we run another time our robot, if the message box will prompt 0 or not. The total number of files are 0, of course, because no files are moved from the source folder to the destination folder.
So in this webinar, we first saw on the basics of robotic process automations, then we are going to the difference between attended and unattended automation. We saw the different steps to conduct an RPA project. Then we see how we can use UiPath Studio, and we developed two software robots within UiPath Studio. Then in the next webinar, we are going to encode more complex software robots.